would you help explain the difference between Atman and Jivatma?
Yes, it's a very important question. Just as a look, there are two issues where I refocus the mind of the Hindus. The first one is about making sure you know the difference between the idea of Puran, legendary stories, mm-hmm. and the idea of Upanishads, which are more spiritual, which are more philosophically, rationally founded, very beautiful material at the heart of your tradition. You can't see distinguish. This gives a big problem for you because you are just focusing on Puran, legendary stories, and you get knocked about by the world mm-hmm. saying, come on, this can't be real. You believe in stuff there like this. Mm-hmm. So please, first distinction I make is make distinction between Puran as legendary stories and live with it, enjoy them, but know their limitation. The second issue that Hindus kind of struggle with is, and I've seen it again and again being kind of bombarded all over the place, and there's such serious misunderstanding regarding the word Atman and Jivatman. Let me touch on it again. It's very important. Now, Bhagavad Gita will say, Atman is never born, never dies. And you say, wow, chapter 2, wow, wonderful. And then at every cremation ceremony I go, the priest will say, the Atman was very good, he has departed now. Now, Bhagavad Gita says, Atman doesn't come and go. So why are you saying the Atman is departed? The answer is this. The poor priest, most of Hindus don't know the difference between the word Atman and Jivatman. Jivatman appears like a bigger word. There's Jiv and then Atman at the end. So bigger word must be bigger. And Atman is teeny, teeny, tiny word. Atman must be little tiddler. And Jivatman is big one. Let me show you the difference. In fact, it's exactly the opposite. Jivatman is a tiddler and Atman is the real daddy, real father. I give an example, a beautiful example. It's a metaphor, but it's a very wonderful one. And I've used it again and again. I keep using it. If you go to the seaside on a sunny day, you look over the cliff and you see the whole sea, all the waves sparkling. And the crest of every wave, you see a spark. Yahoo! Yahoo! And the sparks, when the wave disappears, the spark disappears. And again the wave reappears and the spark reappears at the top of the wave, the crest of the wave. And you look at when you look from outside, see that the whole sea has come alive. There's so many living things bubbling on top of the surface of the water. This is what it appears, isn't it? Very real. And yet we know that in no stage did the sun come down to the sea. They were just reflected by the water. This is the difference between Atman and Jivatman. Atman is that spirit that is never born, never dies, but it appears to have been encapsulated in the wave, in the mind and body complex. So Atman appearing as the individual, me with my intelligence and my mind and everything, is Jivatman. If you like an appearance of Atman captured in the mind, body, intellect and ego concept, it gets captured into it, just like a little sparkle at the top of the crest of a whale. It seems to have individuality, and yet there is no individuality. It seems to be very individual. It appears and disappears. Jivatman comes and goes. The sparkle appears and disappears and reappears somewhere else in another body. But the thing that is really up there has never come down to the water. Atman is, that's why you say Atman never comes, never goes. Jivatman all the time comes and goes. And it's so important for us to make this distinction because we keep, and I see a lot of, you know, quite important Hindu speakers making this mistake. They kind of use the word soul to mean Atman. Soul is not Atman, soul is Jivatman.
Jivatman.
Atman is dramatically different. It is nothing like the soul. Soul is Jivatman. Spirit appear to have been captured by the body-mind complex is called Jivatman, the soul. The soul travels. Soul has got up good things, bad things. The Atman doesn't capture, has any of these attributes. This is make this distinction. I see this all the time. And many important speakers keep messing this up as well. And I shy away from it. I say, come on, this is not right.
So relating to this, we've got another question.
Can I tell one other thing, mm-hmm. just to kind of lighten up? Now see, this is true also with the images we use. And I'll give you a very important example. There was this major temple in London, I won't mention it by name, where they had got, of course we like deities, we like to show God with form and name and form, we love it, Sagun, Sakar, Ishwar. So we show the various gods and goddesses in various guises, you know, Vishnu with four arms and Shiva sitting under meditation, all that. So this temple had all these gods and goddesses, and also there was an image of Hanuman there. Now the image of Hanuman there we're depicting was Hanuman holding a gada and holding a woman by her hair, ready to hit the woman, pulling her hair and hitting her with a gada. Now you see, this is a Hindu temple in London. Imagine a Westerner going to visit the temple. He'll go there, he'll look at all these weird gods and goddesses, four heads and, you know, elephant head, and then suddenly comes to Hanuman. This is the worst thing. He'll look and say, my God, here is the Hindu monkey god thumping a poor woman, dragging her by her hair and hitting her with a gada, with a, you know, mace. This is what? This is Hinduism. They just smile, you know, very sincere, saying, oh, this Hinduism. We say, yes, this is Hinduism, hero, Hanuman, master of strength. So this used to happen. And I used to visit the temple. Then the head of the temple was a very personal friend. So I said, look, my friend, I like all your colorful images, but this image, you need to take it out. It's giving the wrong impression regarding Hinduism and poor Hanuman. This is not right. He said, but Mr. Lakhani, that woman is panoti, you know, bad luck. So Hanuman is saying, I'll thump out your bad luck. But I say, it looks like a woman being beaten up by a monkey god. So please, this imagery is wrong. And they actually smiled and they listened. They didn't acknowledge what I did, what I told them. But quietly, that particular image of Hanuman was done visurgent, you know, immersed in the water. And another image appeared with Hanuman holding a gada and a mountain. Fine enough. Men of strength. But you see, these things happen all the time. And again, in some temples, when the children go, the person who is kind of taking them for a conductor will say, oh, come on, now it's time to go and visit the idols. Idols means you're worshipping objects. Don't use the word idols. Say, we're going to visit the deities. The imageries that we use to relate to the idea of God and spirituality. Don't say idols. Idols is the worst word to use. That's why people are pointing to your idolatrous. And our Hindu temple says, yes, let's go and visit the idols. No idols.